She's one of the brightest stars of stage and screen, and all of Chicago is proud to call her our very own. Takeyah Crystal Keymah of In Living Color finally brought her long-awaited one-woman show back to Chicago. And Some of My Best Friends is one of the best presentations anyone could ever want to see.
I guess I was supposed to tell my boy not to go off and fight in this thing. That's what Eartha said. That blacks ain't got no business over there. That I shouldn't have let him join up in the first place. Let him.
Takeyah, tell our viewers about the concept for Some of Your Best Friends. How did you come up with this show?
Well, it's been something that I've been working on for a couple of years now. And I had the thought to do it ever since I did a one-woman show while in college at Florida A&M University. I did a show based on Ntozake Shange's work, and I wanted to do something of my own work and of other people's work that I admired. And I've been working on a number of characters for a couple of years, and I put them together with this title because I think each of them is a little bit off-center. And sometimes you meet people who are a little off-center and you think, oh, I could never be friends with them. But once you get to know them, you find that you could.
Dorothy wanted to dance, like the girls in the class at the neighborhood center. But her parents agreed that an art class indeed would be a much better choice for Dorothy to enter.
In her collection of poems, stories, and short scenes, Miss Keymah spotlighted a myriad of characters, ranging from soul-searching businesswomen to streetwise teenagers plus frustrated actresses.
Monique is the struggling, working, unemployed, shy, bold, acting, speaking, aspiring actress.
Can you introduce us?
I'm gonna get a part, and it's gonna be a good part. It's not gonna be another prostitute. I don't know why I do that. I'm gonna stop and do good things from now on, I think.
What about Lillian Black White?
Lillian Black White is sophisticated, successful, busy, successful. Did I say successful?
I think you did.
Woman. And nothing else matters.
While being reared in the Windy City, she was known to family and friends as Crystal Walker. Miss Keymah told Urban Street why she changed her name.
Well, I was born Crystal Walker and remained so for a long time, even though I knew for a long time that I wanted to change my name. When I was very young, I learned that Walker, which was my given name, was a name that I had obtained through slavery. It wasn't through any kind of love relationship or anything. And I thought that I wanted to release it from my energy. And I looked for a name for a long time that was more appropriate. And a few years ago, I chose one and adopted it as my own. Takeyah means a mental revival of God's spirit. And Keymah means to establish oneself, to come to one's feet.
Miss Keymah is joining forces with Craig Hodges of the world champion Chicago Bulls to spearhead Operation Unite to save the youth.
Well, Takeyah is a great sister, and I think more importantly, is one of those people that comes along at a time in your history that you need someone to step forward and take and make a sacrifice. And I think that's something that she's done with her life, and just a person that will change the name to show how they feel about themselves is something in itself. But she's one of the people who's very instrumental in Operation Unite, along with a lot of other athletes and entertainers. And that's what Operation Unite is all about, is to try to bring athletes and entertainers together so that we can harness our talent and use our talent as a natural resource for the African-American community, so that we can harness the dollars and go back and reinvest it in jobs and housing and just those necessities that we need.
I met Craig at the expo in Indianapolis this summer, and was quite impressed with him and with an idea that he had for an organization, Operation Unite. And it's something that certainly is one of my goals, to do work that benefits everyone in the community. And it's an umbrella organization that will not compete with other organizations, but will work to bring a more cohesive pattern through the community.
Tell us about your childhood here in Chicago. Every time you've been on the radio with me, we've had people call in and testify about your childhood. What type of child was Crystal Walker, Takeyah Keymah?
I don't know. I think I was a variety of children. I was very loud and obnoxious at home and always doing plays and forcing my family to sit through them. I was very shy and quiet at school, and I got good conduct awards. And I kept to my family and my immediate family and my close cousins.
My sources tell me you ran away from home on the CTA once.
I think that is required of children, is it not?
How did that happen?
Well, I don't know. The plan, actually, was to live downtown in Marshall Field's bathroom, because I was very little and I thought that it was very big and one could live there. So I got some other gal from the block, and we went on the bus and told the bus driver, let us know when we're downtown. And that was a clue to him to return us home.
My name is Shantifa Joyce Washington, and this is my poem. We be doing it. We be doing it. Me and Ben, that's right, and I ain't even ashamed to stand up here in English class and call his name. We be doing it. Out and in with the thigh at him on, cause when we doing it, can't nobody tell us we ain't grown. We be doing it. Around and around.
And last but not least, one of my best friends and one of the audience best friends, and I know one of yours, Shantifa. Tell us about her.
Well, Shantifa is 15 years old, but she's gonna be 16 soon, and that is old enough to be grown. And anyway, the way that everything is so crazy in her house, she feels like whatever she does with her boyfriend is just fine. Until she find out something different.
Laundry to wash? Then save your pennies by taking it into a secondhand shop. They'll do all the dirty work for you, and you can buy it all back for next to nothing. This money-saving tip was brought to you by McDonald's, where now you can get a tasty double cheeseburger for just 99 cents every day.
To the Star Plaza Theater, Saturday, January 18th, are the Legends of Rhythm and Blues, starring the Mighty Dales, the Iceman, Jerry Butler, and the Duke of Earl, Gene Chandler. It's an all-star night of soul, so order your tickets now at the Star Plaza box office at 773-734-7266 to see the Dales, Jerry Butler, and Gene Chandler at the Star Plaza Theater.
Laundry to wash? Then save your pennies by taking it into a secondhand shop. They'll do all the dirty work for you, and you can buy it all back for next to nothing. This money-saving tip was brought to you by McDonald's, where now you can get a tasty double cheeseburger for just 99 cents every day.
So many things happening with our youth today, from 90s-style songs exhibiting an endorsement of sexual behavior to the violent images in African-American motion pictures. And let us not forget the duplication of style in fashion. Urban Street asked our mental health expert, Dr. Carl Bell, to analyze what influences our youth in the 90s.
You're hard to get. You just don't know you haven't met the brains yet. At the beginning, it's my game is kicking. But at the end, it's the
all of the commercial trappings for black youth, the Malcolm X caps, the starter jackets, the Air Jordan shoes. Is there a sense of identity there? Why do you think the youth need that to espouse their blackness?
Adolescence is a very strange time of life because you are in the process of trying to leave home emotionally and become your own person. And what do? You tell your parents, you can't tell me what to do. I'm not going to conform to anything you tell me. And then you go act and dress and talk exactly like everybody in your peer group, because that's where you get your emotional support from. So that a lot of the trappings that we see are really psychological efforts to maintain a psychological support system. Funny haircuts, certain sorts of clothes. The problem is that some teens use what they are wearing as a mark of their self-esteem. And so you then start seeing crime, violent crime, and robbery, instrumental violence over give me that hat, give me those boots, give me that jacket. Because self-esteem is tied into what you're wearing. And that is where that the use of those articles of clothing goes too far. But I mean, if you look at America, that's what most people here do. So the children are just following suit, unfortunately.
Can they make a distinction between self-esteem and black pride? And for example, the Malcolm X hats, do you believe most of them wear that as a form of self-esteem, or they want to espouse their black pride?
It's hard to tell. Self-esteem is the difference between what you think you are and what you think you should be. So if I think I should be the executive director of a community mental health center, and I am, then I'm okay. But if I think that I should be, God forbid, the president of the United States, and I don't reach that goal, then my self-esteem is going to be very low. Even though I might be well thought of and liked, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that there has to be an adjustment between what you are and what you think you ought to be. The manner in which children, adolescents, and adults work that out is a very complicated one. One of the studies that have been done by Lawrence and Gary up at Howard University has shown that adults who have a strong sense of their ethnic identity are less likely to use drugs. How many black Muslims do you know are selling crack cocaine to their community? How many legitimate black ministers do you know are selling crack cocaine in black community? You just don't do that. If you have a sense of pride in black nationalism, you do not engage in genocidal behaviors. One of the problems is that a lot of the black pride, African-American pride, is really somewhat superficial. We all know what Harriet Tubman did, but not many of us have read her life story and understand that she did more than just be the Black Moses. She did all kinds of things. Newspaper, sewing show, I mean, just all kinds of different activities. And because our black history a lot of times only is a headline, and we don't really have the whole story, the pride is a superficial one, and it really doesn't have depth.
In our conversation with University of Illinois staff psychologist Dr. Renee Redd concerning our youth, we explored relationships and sexual attitudes between males and females.
Society sends women the message, and even though we're supposedly living in a more liberated time, it still sends a message, and women still, a lot of young women still believe that my value and worth and what I get out of life is the man that I'm attached to. And so they go after the prize man.